Good morning. Aren't we just having a wonderful day to come and worship our Lord and Savior? Why don't we stand as we start the service with Jesus Messiah?
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become His righteousness. He humbled Himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah.
Another this morning.
Once and then just to We sing about praising the name of the Lord, blessed be his name. The question is, if Jesus walked into your house, how would you honor him? If he came for lunch, would you say, well, Jesus, we didn't plan much, but we're glad to have you, but I get the big piece of pie. No, of course not. We'd say, quick, run out, get some really nice steaks because Jesus is coming today. We honor Jesus by showing him his worth. But Jesus said one of the ways we honor him is by giving back. Each week we take an offering. And when it comes time for the offering, think again, how do you honor Christ? Do you reach in your pocket and pull out a couple quarters? Do you find a dollar or two that you can pull out of your wallet? Or do you give extravagantly because you want to honor the one that you love so much? God doesn't want us to give everything, but he does want us to honor him with the first portion of all he's blessed us with. So this morning, as the ushers come, don't give grudgingly, don't give stingily, but give cheerfully as unto the Lord. Let's pray. Father, it is a joy and a delight to honor you through giving. You've provided abundantly for us. And so, Lord, as we give back, we pray that you would use what is given for your glory. We ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus, my Lord.
Why don't we stand?
This morning, if you have your Bibles, I would invite you to turn with me to the book of Genesis, Genesis chapter 28. Genesis is the first book in the Bible, so it is a very easy one for us to find. We've been going through the book of Acts, looking at the spread of the gospel in the early church. Last week we ended in chapter 20, and from there on records the story of Paul on his way to Rome. And we are not going to be picking that up at this time, so by all means read through the rest of the book of Acts. We may come back to that for another day for the last eight chapters. But today we want to look at this idea of names. We have sung about the name of Jesus. And we want to think this morning about the importance of a name. Shakespeare has a famous line from Romeo and Juliet
a rose by any other name would smell as sweet. You read that and you think, well, names aren't really all that important, are they? But in the Bible, names have great significance. You think about Abram. Remember, before he was Abraham, he used to be called Abram, which means exalted father. And God promises him that his descendants are going to be like the sands of the seashore, like the stars in the heavens. And as a sign of that commitment, God changes his name from Abram to Abraham, which means father of a great multitude. Think about the baby John the Baptist. When he's born, remember his father Zacharias has been serving in the temple and he is visited by an angel, and he doesn't believe the angel because his wife Elizabeth is barren. And so the angel says, fine, you won't be able to speak until your son is born. And he lives then for 9 months of silence. When the baby is born, they want to call him Zachariah after his father. And God loosens his tongue and says, his name is John, because it was very important what his name was. And then you think of Jesus, who when he is born is given the name Jesus because, as it says in Luke, you are to give him the name Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. So names have great significance. This Tuesday, Rhonda and I will be celebrating 25 years of marriage. And 25 years ago, she took my name as her own. Names identify us. Names play a great significance in our lives. And today, we've come out here to worship at Bethel. And we understand that this congregation has a name as well. We call ourselves Bethel Evangelical Free Church. And today I want us to think about why we call ourselves Bethel. 30-some years ago when the church was being started, I don't think they got together and said, well, let's pull out a book of church names and let's find a name we like. Well, this one sounds good. This one sounds good. How do you like this one? They didn't just pick it at random. Instead, there is a meaning behind the name Bethel, and that's what we want to look at today, to remind ourselves what that name means and what it means for us, why we exist, and how that name should impact our lives. The name Bethel is the name of a place in the Bible. It's a place where several things take place. It is where Rachel dies when she gives birth to her son Benjamin. In the book of Judges, Deborah, a prophetess, held court under the palm of Deborah, which was near Bethel. Elijah had a school of the prophets. He built his own seminary at Bethel. Lots of things happened at Bethel, but the events we want to look at this morning involve another character whose name is Jacob. Bethel is a Hebrew name that means house of God. And it came to be used as a name for a very specific place because of what happens at this place. And that's the story we see here in Genesis 28. Here we find the story of a scoundrel, a deceiver, a manipulator named Jacob. Jacob is the younger of two twins, Jacob and Esau. Most of us remember the story of those boys. Jacob was the mama's boy. Esau was dad's son, favorite son. But Jacob swindles the birthright, an extra portion of the inheritance from his brother. He buys it for a bowl of chili. And it earned him probably a couple extra million dollars. Then he steals his brother's blessing by deceiving his father, dressing up like his brother. And when Esau finds out, he's mad enough he wants to kill his brother. So Jacob gets out of town. He says, you know what? I think I want to go visit mom's family and go see how grandma's doing on mom's side. So he starts a 400-mile journey. And he gets about 60 miles north of his home. It's late. He's tired. He lies down to sleep. He doesn't have any comforts. He doesn't have a nice cot, nice sleeping bag. He lies in the ground and uses a rock for a pillow. And that brings us to what we find here in Genesis 28, verse 10. Jacob left Beersheba, set out for Haran. When he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. There above it stood the Lord. And he said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it. He was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. Early the next morning, Jacob took the stone he had placed under his head and set it up as a pillar, and poured oil on top of it. He called that place Bethel, though the city used to be called Luz. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, if God will be with me and will watch over me on this journey I am taking, and will give me food to eat and clothes to wear so that I return safely to my father's house, then the Lord will be my God, and this stone that I have set up as a pillar will be God's house. And of all that you give me, I will give you a tenth. Let's pray together. Father, today we have just read your words, and now as we consider what they mean, we pray that your Holy Spirit would speak to each one of us and give us insight, give us application, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. When we think about the name Bethel, what does that name imply for us? First of all, Bethel is a place to meet with God. Jacob didn't plan on it. He's just traveling along in this time to sleep. He didn't expect to meet with God. If you had asked him, he probably would have said he didn't want to meet with God because he's feeling a little bit guilty about what he's done, stealing from his brother. He's a man on the run, and he's done some terrible things. He would surely be ashamed to stand in the presence of God. But just the same, God showed up and forever changed his life. The society Jacob lived in, they all had their regional gods, their local deities. In the scriptures, it talks about Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, Chemosh, the god of the Moabites, Molech, the god of the Ammonites, Dagon, the god of the Philistines. So each of the little communities and people groups all have their own separate deities that they worship. And so as Jacob is leaving his home, it might have been very easy to think, well, God, he's back home with my father and with my grandfather. But he's traveling 3 days from home, and as he falls asleep, his God, Jacob's God, comes and meets with him. And to make it clear, God says in verse 13, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham, and the God of Isaac. Jacob hasn't always done a very good job of honoring God. But God is meeting with him nonetheless. God met with Jacob at Bethel. In the same way, whenever we think about coming to Bethel, before we think about the people we'll see, Such smiling faces, great people. Before we think about programs, before we think about ministries, anytime we come together, we want to think about meeting with God. Because sometimes we lose that focus. We come out of ritual, Sunday morning, let's get up, we got to go to church. And we come sometimes without even thinking about being in the presence of God. One little boy was getting ready. He was saying his prayers one Sunday night, and he had had such a good day. And he says, God, I had a wonderful time at church today. You should have been there. Well, let's realize that anytime we come together, we come in the presence of God. We come to meet with God. If God ever didn't show up, what a mess our world would be in. But we have that promise from Matthew 18, for where two or three come together in my name, there I am with them. So God promises to meet us here. And because God is present, that is a big deal for us. We never want to take it for granted. Because it's so easy to fall into the routine of church. You know, come in, sing the song, stand up, sit down, take the offering, preach, go home. And we sometimes miss the awe of being in the presence of the one who spoke everything into existence just by his word. We sometimes lose the wonder of the greatness of our God. So Bethel is a place to meet God. And just like Jacob, sometimes when we come to Bethel, we come into the house of God, we really aren't in a very good place, spiritually speaking. Sometimes when we come together, we come because it's Sunday, it's our routine, it's our ritual, and we know we ought to be there, but we know we're not right with God. And so we put up our walls, we put on our masks, we smile and say, well, praise the Lord, how are you this morning? When inside we're torn apart. Sometimes the last thing we want to think about is meeting with God when we come out together. Because we've been running from God all week long. But the good news for us that we see over and over again in Scripture is that even when we are running from God, He pursues us. He initiates relationship with us. Think all the way back to Adam. Remember, he has eaten the forbidden fruit. God says, you can have any fruit except that one tree. And that's the one. The serpent gets Eve to take. She gives to Adam, who's standing right there silent the whole time. And then they realize they're naked and they are ashamed and they hide. But what does God do? God comes and pursues. Adam, where are you? Not because God couldn't find him, but he wants Adam to see where he is. And God pursues the relationship. He takes animal skins and clothes them. He renews relationship with them. Today, you might be here and you came to church, but you know something's not right. Let's realize as we meet with God, nothing shocks God. God knows everything we've done. And we don't have to hide. Remember the story of the prodigal son who goes off into the far country, wastes the whole inheritance. And he comes back with his tail tucked between his legs. And what's the father do? The father's been watching, and father sees him at a distance and comes running. We never have to hide from God. God really defines himself by his great forgiveness for us. In Exodus 34, Moses has an encounter with God. And Moses says, I want to see your face. God says, you can't look in my face. You wouldn't even be able to live. But I tell you what, you hide in the cleft of the rock in the crevice, and I'll pass by, and you can just see my glory after I pass by. And as the Lord goes by, he declares his name. He says, then the Lord came down in the cloud and stood there with him and proclaimed his name, the Lord. And he passed in front of Moses proclaiming, "The Lord, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin." We have a God who is so quick to forgive when we will confess. So even though we may have been running as we come together in the house of God, we have a God who loves to meet with us. And whenever we meet with God, we're changed. Two things happen. We receive a blessing, and we become a blessing. Look what happens to Jacob. First of all, he receives a blessing. If you look at verse 13, actually start back in verse 12. "He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it." You want to talk about something sensational? Here is a sensational vision. But notice, Jacob doesn't focus on that part. He doesn't focus on the sensational. His focus is on the Lord. A young couple from the hills of Arkansas got involved in a church where they were used to a lot of shouting and clapping and running down the aisles for Jesus. And that happens down south. I went to a church where, you know, they'd take out their hankies and wave them. They run in the aisles. Well, anyways, they were trying to convince grandma that she should attend. "You should have seen," the young man said to grandma. "The Spirit of God was really there. The music was rocking the place. It was awesome." Grandma just kept rocking in her chair, didn't say a word. "And grandma," said the young woman, "you should have heard the preacher. He was really with it today. He was shouting and screaming at the top of his lungs, and people were popping up like popcorn praising the Lord. It was unbelievable." Again, grandma just kept on rocking. Finally, the young man said, "Grandma, don't you like our church?" Grandma finally stopped rocking and said, "Honey, let me just put it this way. I don't care how loud they shout, and I don't care how high they jump. It's what they do when they come back down that counts." So many people focus on the show, and they miss the presence of the Most High God. Not Jacob. He forgets about the angels. He forgets about the stairway. He focuses on his God. And what does God do? God blesses him. Take a moment and think. If you were Jacob, if you had just cheated your brother out of his wealth, cheated your brother out of his blessing, lied and deceived your father, you were running for your life, and you met up with God, would you expect a blessing? Not at all. We'd be expecting God to show up to strike us down. Punishment, yes. Definitely not a blessing. But look at what God says in verse 13. "There above it stood the Lord. He said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham, the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you're lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south." So why would God withhold punishment and instead offer blessing? Because God is the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. So many times we come to the house of God, and when we meet with God, he pours out a blessing that we do not deserve. His blessing is not earned. We can't barter with God for a blessing. We can't buy, well, you know, I'll give more money because I want God to give me more back. Anytime we try to manipulate God, we'll fall flat on our face. But God, out of his pure grace for us, offers us a blessing that we do not deserve. Matthew 7 reminds us, "If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him?" So God shows up at the house of God, and Jacob is changed. He's given a great blessing, but then the next thing that happens, Jacob is given the blessing so that he can become a blessing. It says, all peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. Why does God bless Jacob? So he in turn can pass that blessing on to others. And it's the same way for you and me. Why does God bless us much more than our sins deserve? Because God wants us to go and be a blessing to others as well. Romans 12 tells us, share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless. And do not curse. Somebody cuts you off in traffic. Is your first response to bless them or curse them? Somebody does something mean to you. Somebody says something about you. Is your response to bless them? Many times it's not. But God wants us to, he gives us blessing when we deserve punishment so that we in turn can bless others as well. Think about some scriptures that remind us of this. Proverbs 28, 27. He who gives to the poor will lack nothing. But he who closes his eyes to them receives many curses. Proverbs 22, 9. A generous man will himself be blessed, for he shares his food with the poor. Proverbs 11, 25. A generous man will prosper, for he who refreshes others will himself be refreshed. So whenever we come to Bethel, to the house of God and meet with God, we always want to think about how we can be a blessing to others. Sadly, the truth, though, is many times we come to Bethel so that others can be a blessing to us. We don't come right out and say that, but when we come together, what do we think? I hope they sing songs that I like. You know, I hope the pastor preaches on something that I want to hear. You know, I hope during the greeting time somebody comes and shakes my hand. Instead of thinking about others that we can go and greet and bless and encourage and pray for, so many times we come with a consumer mindset. It's all about me. Instead, come with a minister mindset. Think, I want to look for somebody I can encourage today. Oh, there's somebody who looks a little bit down. I'm going to go sit and talk with them for a little bit. You know, maybe I can invite so-and-so over to the house later on. And instead of looking for somebody to bless you, look to be a blessing to somebody else. Every month we have a food distribution here. And God has provided wonderfully for the ministry. Could the people turn somewhere else for help? Sure they could. Many of them go several places because they need the extra help. But it's wonderful to know that they can come here. And when they come, they know that they are loved. They're prayed with. They're pointed to the one who can help with whatever problems they're facing. So whenever we come to the house of God, we are changed. We meet with God. And I hope that every time you come to Bethel, you meet with God here, and you are changed as a result of it. I hope you always leave with your heart a little bit lighter. Burdens seem a little bit less. And I hope that whenever you meet with God, God in turn uses you to be a blessing to others. So we come to worship. As we do, we are blessed and we are changed to be a blessing to others. There's another unique feature about meeting with God, and that is, sometimes we don't realize we have met with God until after the fact. You look at Jacob here in verse 16. When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, surely the Lord is in this place and I was not aware of it. And then he's afraid. So many times we come to church, we are not expecting to meet with God. We might have a bitter attitude. We might not really want to be here, but we come anyways because our spouse said we've got to go today. Sometimes we're mad at our spouse for something that happened on the way. We fidget and we complain, saying, the music's loud, or somebody's singing off key, or, they're trying to get money. And Many times we come and worshiping God's the last thing on our mind, and yet in spite of that, God will do amazing things. And many times it's not until after the fact we realize, you know, God really got a hold of my heart today. You know what? God really spoke to me about this area of my life. And so many times, it's not until the end of a service that that same person who came in grumpy and bitter is humming a song as they're walking out, because they realize God has met with them, their heart has been lifted, their burdens have been taken away. And even in spite of not expecting anything, they realize, I truly did meet with God today. So what's in the name? Bethel is the house of God. Whenever we come, we should expect to meet God here. Second thing about Bethel, Bethel is a place of commitment. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, if God will be with me and will watch over me on this journey I am taking and will give me food to eat and clothes to wear so that I return safely to my father's house, then the Lord will be my God. And this stone that I have set up as a pillar will be my God's, will be God's house. And of all that you give me, I will give you a tenth. After meeting with God, Jacob knows that there is a response he needs to make. He commits to following God and worshiping him. The wonderful thing about making commitments is we don't have to clean up our life before we make them. We come to God as we are. God sees us right where we are, and we can make a commitment, though, that no matter how bad of shape we are in, we don't have to hide from God, but we can make that commitment that, God, with your help, I'm going to change. God welcomes us to make a commitment to change, to be more like him. He always leaves us the choice. He is always ready to help. He's always ready to give us everything we need. But we have the choice of whether or not we will make that commitment. One time when I was at another church, I'd asked some different leaders of the church what really spoke to them, helped them spiritually in the church service. And one friend said that he valued the chance to make a commitment. Because yes, it's good to come and meet with God, but when God speaks to us, remember James says, don't be like the person who looks in the mirror and goes away and just stays the same person. When God meets with us, we want to make a commitment to change. We want to make a commitment to act upon the things that he speaks to our heart about. And so Jacob, when he meets with God, makes a commitment here. In verse 20, the if found here can really be read since. Jacob's not making a bargain with God. He's not saying, if you give me this, then I'll give you this. Rather, he is affirming his faith in God, saying, God, I know you're going to be with me. Since you are going to be with me, I plan on coming back and worshiping you. In light of all that God has done for us, how can we not serve him? Bethel is a place where we can meet with God. Bethel is a place where we can make a commitment to God. We go on then to see Bethel, thirdly, is a place of security. If you page forward a little bit over to Genesis 35, here we find, as Paul Harvey would say, the rest of the story. In the intervening chapters, Jacob has fled to his uncle's house, gotten married twice to two sisters. He's fathered over a dozen kids. He's built a whole herd of cattle. Now he comes back home to make peace with his family. He meets his brother Esau, and he's so worried about it, but God intervenes and lets everything work out just fine. He settles near Shechem. While he's at Shechem, two of his sons, Simeon and Levi, get all the neighbors so stirred up, they're ready to come and attack Jacob and his family. So Jacob is a desperate man. He's got to leave Shechem. He's got to go somewhere. Where is he going to go? Bethel. Chapter 35, starting in verse 1. Then God said to Jacob, go up to Bethel and settle there. and build an altar there to God, who appeared to you when you were fleeing from your brother Esau. So Jacob said to his household and to all who were with him, get rid of the foreign gods you have with you and purify yourselves and change your clothes. Then come, let us go up to Bethel, and where I will build an altar to God, who answered me in the day of my distress, who has been with me wherever I have gone. So they gave Jacob all the foreign gods they had and the rings in their ears, and Jacob buried them under the oak at Shechem. Then they set out, and the terror of God fell upon the towns all around them, so that no one pursued them. Jacob and all the people with him came to Luz, that is Bethel, in the land of Canaan. There he built an altar, and he called the place El Bethel, because it was there that God revealed himself to him when he was fleeing from his brother. Now Deborah, Rebekah's nurse, died and was buried under the oak below Bethel. So it was named Alon Bakuth. After Jacob returned from Padan Aram, God appeared to him again and blessed him. God said to him, your name is Jacob, but you will no longer be called Jacob. Your name will be Israel. So he named him Israel. And God said to him, I am God Almighty. Be fruitful and increase in number. A nation and a community of nations will come from you, and kings will come from your body. The land I gave to Abraham and Isaac, I also give to you, and I will give this land to your descendants after you. Then God went up from him at the place where he had talked with him. Jacob set up a stone pillar at the place where God talked with him, and he poured out a drink offering on it. He also poured oil on it. Jacob called the place where God had talked with him Bethel. When Jacob needs help, when he needs a place of safety to return to, God sends him to Bethel. The house of God is a place where we can always turn when we are confronted by fears, worries, burdens, anxiety. Instead of trying to handle our problems all on our own, we come to the house of God and we find grace to help in time of need. Peter reminds us, cast all your cares on him, because he cares for you. We always want Bethel to be a place of safety, a place of relief and comfort, a place of hope and healing. Whenever we and others have needs, burdens, worries, we come to the house of God. And we don't have to pretend that we have everything together. In the same way, we want to make sure that people don't feel condemned when they come. We want everyone to be honest about the things they struggle with, because we are all fellow strugglers. Far too often we put a mask on so that nobody sees us, and then we look down on others who admit their failings. Instead, we always want Bethel to be a place of security, a place where people can be free to be themselves and to share their burdens and find help from one another, bearing one another's burdens and so fulfilling the law of Christ. And then the fourth thing we see, Bethel is a place of continual worship. As Jacob returns to Bethel, the place where he met God years before, he once again worships God. And it's a reminder for us, worship is an ongoing act. We can't say, oh, I've worshiped God before, I don't need to worship him again. It's a continual act. In Revelation 4, we're given a scene from heaven, and it tells us that worship is constantly ongoing. It says, day and night, they never stop saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. It would be ridiculous to think that we could ever give God enough worship, that we could ever praise him enough. So Jacob comes back to Bethel and continues to worship his God. And in this passage, we find some reminders. Before we can rightly worship, we need to purify ourselves. As Jacob gets ready to meet God in his worship, he knows that there is some cleaning up to be done. Some of his family have idols that they have been worshiping. They need to get rid of them. For us, that means searching our hearts and saying, what are the idols in our life that hinder us from worship? And as we come to meet with God and to worship our God, we need to think, what is it that I need to get rid out of my life? If we're thinking, well, I'll just come to church and put on a good show, we might as well just stay home and sleep. The rest is going to do us a whole lot more good. It's meaningless to sing, "All to Jesus I surrender," when we know, but I'm not going to surrender this. You know, think, "I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God," when you're thinking, but I sure don't like my brother who sits across the sanctuary because I've got a grudge against him. So many times we come to the house of God, we come to worship God, but to be honest, we need sometimes just to do some house cleaning before we come to worship. Because to truly worship God, to truly have him do his work in our hearts, we need to get rid of some of the baggage that accumulates there. We also see that who we worship is more important than how we worship. In verse 7, Jacob builds an altar. He names it El Bethel, which means God of Bethel. God of the house of God. What was important to Jacob was who he was worshiping. God. As we meet together, we need to always remember our worship is done to an audience of one. If you sing off key, sing off key as unto the Lord. Don't worry about what the person down the row is going to think. Because we're not trying to impress them. We're singing to worship God. When it comes time for the offering, if all you have is 2 quarters to give, don't worry that you're not putting a 20 or a 50 into the offering plate. Because we're not giving to impress the person behind us who sees what we're giving. We're giving out of worship of God. What's truly important is God of the house of God. So many times people get caught up in how they worship. Where are we going to sing, hymns or choruses? Traditional or contemporary? And so many times it's surface things that are not that important. We always want to make sure that our God is the one who is important in our worship. Who we worship is more important than how we worship. Here at Bethel, we need to be a place where we meet God, make commitments to God, a place of security and hope, and we need to be a people who continually worship. Notice that Jacob uses a visible reminder of his need to worship. In verses 7 and 14, we see Jacob building altars. And in our lives, reminders are very helpful to us. Many types of reminders we can use. Some people, put up pictures of Jesus in your home. Some people, it's carrying a certain Bible or a certain journal with you. Some people put little things on their keychains, little crosses they wear. Many ways that we can use reminders. But one of the reminders we have been given by our God is communion. We take the bread and the cup together to remind us of the body and blood of Christ that was given for us. To remind us that our salvation is free, but it came with a great cost. Here at Bethel, we have an open communion. You don't have to be a member. We invite you, if your heart is right with God, you've trusted Christ as Savior, to join with us. And before the elders come, we're going to watch a short video to help us prepare. So if you've got some baggage to deal with, by all means, take some time just to pray and prepare your heart. If God has spoken to you about something, make some commitments to the Lord. But this morning, as we prepare for worship, we want to be reminded that we never want to lose the wonder of what our God has done for us.
I will kneel in the dust at the foot of the cross, where mercy paid for me, where the wrath I deserve, it is gone, it has passed, your blood has hidden me. Mercy, mercy,
God, whenever we come to a passage like these that we've looked at today, we are reminded that there is hope for us. Because you see us as we are and you love us in spite of our sin. And your forgiveness is so great. Your mercy is so great. And I thank you, Lord, for what you have done for us in giving your son Jesus. As we take the bread and cup together today, we remember afresh and anew your great salvation. We're reminded that there is no way we could ever earn our salvation or work for our salvation or pay for your forgiveness. But in your love for us, you gave your son Jesus, who became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God through him. And Lord, may we never lose the wonder of being in your presence. May we always remember that whenever we come to the house of God, you are here to meet with us. And we believe that you have spoken to us and changed us today and blessed us today. And now as we take the bread and cup, may we remember afresh and anew all you've done. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I'll ask those who are helping to distribute to come forward at this time. Jesus met with his disciples and they were celebrating the Passover. They were so used to the holiday where they talked about God delivering them in the years past. But Jesus changed the wording that they were so used to and looked forward to what he was planning on doing that next day. He took the bread, he gave it to them, and said that the bread would represent his body that was given. So today we take a piece of bread and we eat it to remember the body of Jesus given for us. Nailed on the cross, beaten, spit upon, his side pierced, taken down, placed in the grave, but then raised from the dead and glorified, ascended up to heaven, and one day soon coming back for us. So as the plates are passed, feel free to take a piece. When everyone is served, we will all eat together. Jesus reminds us the way to be great is to be a servant. We understand that one day God is going to take all of creation and turn it over to his son Jesus. But Jesus modeled that humility by serving us all and dying for us. And so we take the bread and we remember that great sacrifice for us. Father, today we're grateful for your great love for us, your great sacrifice for us. We take the bread and we remember the body of Christ. And now, Lord, as we take the juice, we remember the blood of Jesus that cleanses us from all sin. We are grateful for these reminders we have. And as we take the juice together, may we remember afresh and anew the cost of our salvation. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Once again, we will serve everyone, and when everyone is served, we'll all drink together. Today we think about Jesus who humbled himself, became obedient to death, even death on a cross. As we take the juice, we remember the blood of Jesus given for us. Let's drink and remember. Father, we are so grateful that you did not leave us in your sin, in our sins, as you could have done. But you freely gave us your son, Jesus, your one-of-a-kind son. No one else could have done what he did. And he was willing to leave his glory in heaven to bear our sins upon himself, to face your rejection, to become sin for us. Where it's many times we come and we remember we're saved and we rejoice in that and we forget the great cost. And so, Lord, today we thank you for your great forgiveness through your son Jesus and for all that he did for us. We look forward to the fact that one day you will exalt him. He has a name that is above every name. And at the name of Jesus, every tongue will confess and will bring glory to you, our Father. So, Father, we give you our praise today for this reminder by taking the bread and juice to remember the body and blood of Jesus given for us. Thank you for what you've done for us today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. When Jesus met with his disciples, they shared the Last Supper, the bread and the cup together. And then it says before they went out, they shared a hymn together. And so the praise team's going to come and lead us in one more song. Pray together. Father, it is a joy and a delight to be in your house today, to be in your presence and to worship you. May our lives be characterized by worship every day this week. And may we always remember that wherever we are, you are with us. We praise you for how you've spoken to our hearts today. Dismiss us now with your blessing, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus, Jesus.